everybody. It's Loudon Wainwright with John Broughton on Retrospectives on 3SER, KC Radio.
Music always the career path that you were set for growing up?
Actually, no. I studied drama in the late '60s at a school in here in the States in Pittsburgh called Carnegie Mellon, which is has a very fine drama school. And my intention was to become an actor, but I dropped out of acting school after about a year and a half and spent a little bit of time hitchhiking around America, and then started to write songs in 1968. So I knew how to play the guitar, but I didn't think I was a songwriter. So I was a bit surprised when I found myself getting paid doing that.
Looking back now, do you think the experience you had studying acting, and indeed the acting experience you've had also, has any of that helped you in your stage presence in later years?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly there's an element of what I do that I'm a performer. You know, the songs that I write, I perform them, and I certainly feel I like being on stage, and I'm sure that being in acting school and performing there and learning a little bit about showbiz has been helpful.
So would you consider yourself an on-stage performer above a recording artist?
Well, it's just two different things. I mean, making a record is one thing, and I've been doing that for 30 years. I've made, I don't know, 20 records or something, and doing a live show is a completely different thing. I mean, even though you're, in both cases, you're singing the songs, but it's really apples and oranges.
Mm.
It's hard to compare the two.
Now, you were in contact with fame from a young age. A lot of your school friends were from showbiz families. Did that give you the bug in terms of wanting to get into entertainment yourself?
Well, yeah, my parents lived in Los Angeles when I was little, you know, when I was seven or so. And as you say, I went to grammar school with the children of people in show business, including Liza Minnelli, who was in the first and second grade with me, and I was aware of that world, I suppose. I mean, for birthday parties, we would go on movie sets and locations, and so the idea of being a performer was exciting, and I think probably I started to want to do it around eight or nine.
Did your parents encourage you to pursue music?
Well, they didn't discourage me. I mean, my dad loved to sing and played a little piano and actually wrote a song or two. And so, yeah, I mean, they like most parents, they were concerned that I wouldn't make a living at the things that I loved doing, you know. So I went to school and college, and you know, they wanted me to get a job. But once I started to make a living as a musician, they were quite happy and supportive about that.
Now, it's been more than 30 years since your first album now. Were your ambitions back then to be in the business for the long haul?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I certainly wasn't thinking about what I'd be doing 30 years down the line. You know, at the beginning of my career, I wasn't sure if I was going to be alive past a certain age. You know, when you're young and you're living for the moment a lot. And but sure enough, time goes on, and I'm quite happy to have to still be here. And I feel fortunate that I have this pretty interesting job that you know, writing and performing, and I'm happy to be alive and kicking.
Now, there certainly was a time there in the early '70s when you seemed headed for great fame and fortune. But from other interviews I've read with you, and I get the impression that perhaps you've intentionally shied away from that. Would that be right?
Well, I don't know how intentional it was. I mean, there may have been unconscious things I'm sure I put obstacles in my way. I don't know. I've just been concentrating on writing the songs and doing the show. And in the early 70s, I had a hit record, and that's always a this song called Dead Skunk. And it was quite successful over here. And I suppose that was the moment when I should have made my move, and I could have been writing funny animal songs for the last 20 years. But I decided not to. So, you know, I feel pretty good about the work that I've been doing.
Sure.
And I don't really worry about too much about what could have happened.
Humor is very much a part of your work and always has been. Could you envisage your writing without any trace of humor at all?
Well, I think that there are some of the songs are quite serious, although it's not unheard of to have a song of mine that has a serious nature but yet a joke in it, too. I mean, I like to think that I can be both things. Certainly when you're doing a show, it's an effective way of moving things along, you know, to get an audience laughing and then kind of turn on them, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working on a record now, which is quite serious. And in fact, we're making a joke about the fact that we may not put a funny song on it. It's going to be hard to resist that temptation, but
yeah.
We might do it.
Has anyone ever approached you or suggested to you a career in stand-up comedy?
No, I mean, that's a really hard job. Because I have the guitar, I'm kind of hiding behind the guitar, and I can certainly I enjoy it, again, as I said, making audiences laugh, but stand-up looks a little too scary.
Too
That's
much.
Like working without a net.
Now, a lot of your songs are very personal insight to your family and your life. Are there songs that you've ever regretted releasing to the public because they've perhaps given out too much information?
No, I mean, as you say, I mean, I've written about children and sisters and brothers and parents, and these are the most important people in my life. So it seems to me perfectly natural to write about them.
Mm.
And it's very interesting, you know, to me, my relationships with these people. At the end of the day, you know, I write a song, and in some cases it might be, as they say, close to the bone. But if I think it's a good song, and if I don't think it's gratuitous, I'll sing it in a show or put it on a record, take the consequences.
When listening to other songwriters, is it those personal types of songs that you like to hear?
Actually, I don't like to listen to songwriters.
Really?
Yeah, I like to listen to Thelonious Monk records and Bud Powell and dead jazz pianists.
Oh, really?
But my idea of a bad time would be to spend an afternoon listening to other singer-songwriters. I mean, and there are certainly some great ones out there, and many that I admire. But I'm involved in this own battle with myself about getting songs out, and I don't really need to know what the other guys are doing.
Yeah. I never pictured you as a jazz fan.
Well, it's a fairly recent thing, but I'm kind of into it, and it's a non-threatening form of music for
yeah.
a guy like me, so
really.
I enjoy it.
Troy, you're doing the Port Fairy Folk Festival as well as some club shows in Melbourne. Do your shows vary for a festival as for a club crowd? Are there different types of audiences to play to?
Well, first of all, you have the actual atmosphere. If it's an outdoor thing or under a tent, like at a festival, I mean, that's a that's a trickier situation than a room with four walls or a theater or an auditorium. So you have to make adjustments in every kind of performing situation as to the venue you're in and what's required. But it's a challenge. I mean, I've done Port Fairy before, and I've also played, I think it's the Continental.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, I've done that club in Melbourne, so I know what I'm going to have to do in both cases.
Yeah. How much pre-preparation do you do before going on stage? Do you have a set list with you, or do you pretty much let the mood of the night take you?
I usually know what I'm going to start and finish with, and then I just kind of wing it. I mean, certain combinations of songs work well, so I'll link certain songs, but I haven't been down there in a couple of years, so I suspect that I'll be doing a lot of songs which people may and haven't heard yet, newer songs, and of course some old ones, and see what happens.
Now, you do spend a heck of a long time on the road. Do you are you able to manage to write when you're on the road?
It can happen. I mean, you know, it can happen anywhere. It's like fishing. I mean, I'm always thinking about trying to write a song, and I can go long periods without doing it, but my proverbial line is in the water, so to speak. I mean, if I get an idea or think of a line or see something that pisses me off or amuses me or you know, moves me, I can, you know, jot something down on a piece of paper and put the guitar in my lap and squeeze another one off.
I remember seeing a few years ago a television documentary on yourself, and it mentioned how you toured alone, and the documentary did give the impression that touring was a bit of a lonely existence for you. Is it that way?
Yeah, I mean, touring is the hardest part of this job. I mean, the actual grueling, you know, moving through the airports and traveling on the planes and the hotels, and that stopped being interesting about 25 years ago.
Mm.
And it's lonely, and I do travel alone, but I've also traveled with other people, and I get kind of cranky on the road, so it's probably better that I travel alone. But, you know, as somebody said, they don't pay us for playing, they pay us for getting here.
Yeah.
And when you get on stage, that's when the fun starts. And so the work of my job is really the travel and the hassle of the travel.
What do you do to try and combat the tediousness of it?
I don't know. You know, have a good book and try to have a nap, and you know, the things that people use to combat the fatigue and boredom in every situation.
Now, you spend quite a bit of time living in England. What led you there in the first place, and what was there an element of homesickness that brought you back home again?
My parents lived in England in the 60s, and I had gone over in 67 and spent some time in London and really liked it. And then in the early 70s, I lived there for a while. Very important, influential DJ on Radio 1 in the UK called John Peel. And he was a fan of my earlier records, and you know, played them a lot on his show, and he kind of created an audience for me in the UK, and people in Holland and Scandinavia also listened to his show. So I started to spend a lot of time in Europe, and in 85 I actually moved over there and lived for had a place for 12 years. So England's been a good place for me. I guess proportionately I have a bigger audience there than I have even in America.
Mm-hmm.
And I go there pretty regularly. What brought me back to America wasn't a homesickness so much as I just felt like I needed to be back here, and maybe it was homesickness. I haven't really thought about it, but I'm living in New York now, and quite happy about that.
Now, both your son and your daughter have gone into music. Now, have they
approached you at any stage for career advice?
No, I don't think so. They ignore all my advice, as all young people should. They have, their mom, of course, is Kate McGarrigle, who's a musician, and you know, they grew up in this milieu of guitar cases and pianos and fiddles and banjos and being on stage, and so they're natural at you know, ducks to water, I guess.
Yeah.
And they have great instincts and don't really need a lot of advice. So they're doing okay, those kids.
Yeah, sure. Would you have any advice ready for them if they did come to you?
Get a good accountant.
What about critical appraisal of their work? Have they come to you for that?
What do you mean? If they ask me what I think of their work?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, I tell them what I think of their work, and they tell me what they think of mine. So, you know, they're grown-ups. Rufus is going to be 28, and Martha is going to be 25. So they're out here in the real world, they have their opinions, what do they say down there? Good autumn or good on ya or whatever?
Good on ya, yeah.
That's
the one. Now, you've done some work writing topical songs for public radio over there. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I've been doing that for about 10 years now for NPR, which is National Public Radio, our American kind of, I suppose it'd be like the ABC or something, you know, non-commercial radio. And, I've written a bunch of songs. My last album was called Social Studies, which was kind of a collection of these topical songs. Very refreshing for me to write about subjects other than myself.
Mm.
So this song's about, you know, Clinton and the Republican Senator Jesse Helms and the ice skater Tanya Harding and, baseball and politics and the weather and just general stuff which interests me. They air them on this program called Morning Edition, which is on early in the morning, and it's an exciting way to get a song out there.
So do they contact you with what they want from you, or do you more or less just...
It's a two-way street. If they get an idea, they'll call me, or if I come up with something that I think will be good, I can call them.
Right. How does that compare for you, songwriting-wise, writing for a client and writing, I guess, to a deadline, too?
Well, I seem to be able to do it. It's kind of challenging, you know. If they say we need a song about this or that, and we need it by such and such a day, it's like getting a little kick in the butt. I mean, you got to get to work and get on the case and do it. And I kind of like that because rather than having to sit around for the muse or for the pull on your line, you have to kind of jump out of the boat and go down there and get the fish.
Mm.
But it's interesting, and I've enjoyed the opportunity to do it.
Now, I believe I read you have a role in an upcoming TV series.
Yeah, I'm doing some acting again. I knew I'd be an actor. it's a show that hasn't been aired yet here, but it's for Mr. Murdoch's network, the Fox network.
Oh, good.
And it's a show called Undeclared, which is refers to, it's about college students, university students, first year students, and when they say I'm undeclared, it means that they haven't chosen what their major is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Their major studying thing. So I play the father of one of these kids, we've done 6 episodes, and they're going to air them on television soon, and hopefully I'll become a huge television star.
Now, you've done the rounds of record companies over the years. In general, how have they treated you?
Oh, well, you know, it's a bit like complaining about ex-wives. What good does it do? How did she treat me? Well, you got what you deserved. I don't know. I've been on a lot of labels, and you know, but the beat goes on. I'm making a new record, and that's what's important. So I'm happy again. I'm it's amazing that it's been going on this long, but it's still a pretty interesting job.
Some of the songs on this new record, are you likely to road test them down here?
Oh yeah, yeah. I'll be doing a lot of songs from this record that we're making now.
Fantastic. Okay, Loudon, look, I won't hold you up any longer. Thanks so much for your time.
Good talking to you, John.
It's been an absolute treat talking to you for me, and I'm really looking forward to seeing you down here again. I've caught you on most of your past visits, and it's a night out that you just cannot miss.
Well, I'm looking forward to getting down there, and I'll see you in a couple of weeks.
Most certainly. I'll be there front and center.
Okay.
Thanks, Loudon.
Bye-bye.
All the best. Bye-bye.